Hello, my name is Kevin Williams. I'm a psychiatric PA in Tampa, Florida, and serve as the CEO and lead clinician at On Point Behavior Health. Today, I want to dig into really understanding the screening and diagnosis of the condition called tardive dyskinesia. Just sit back and think about a patient that could be sitting in your office. Now, the patient's a female, 50 years of age. She's been on an antipsychotic, and she's been in your care for now the past couple of years. When you observe her, she's tapping her fingers, she's shifting in her chair, blinking more often than you would expect. And some questions that kind of come to mind that I want you to ponder is, one, is she nervous about something? Did anyone else in your office notice? Did you notice? And if so, what would you ask this particular patient? I ask those questions because these are some of the subtle signs of tardive dyskinesia. And they honestly can be easily missed, which is why today, 6 out of 10 patients are still undiagnosed. So how can we learn as PAs to really recognize TD? One, we need to make sure that we really have a complete medical history, because TD may present itself even after the patient is no longer on the supposed causative agent. It's also important for us to recognize who's at risk, who's commonly at risk as well. And I discussed this in my first video. Next, we should really begin to utilize the Abnormal Involuntary Movement Scale. And this is a structured monitoring screening tool that helps us to not only begin to see them, but measure throughout time. It's often commonly called the AIMS, and you're able to do this AIMS in a structured format or even in a semi-structured format. Now, I hear you. You're thinking, Kevin, you're asking us to do another thing in the visit, but wait a minute, because some of these things are able to be embedded into your visit even while you're assessing your patient for other things. I'll give you some examples. In practice, I actually go out to the waiting room, get the patient, and then bring them back into the room so that I can assess their gait, and that's a portion of the AIMS. I'm looking to see if there's any rigidity in their arm sway or maybe reduced arm swaying. I'm looking to see how they're responding to walking and turning and swaying, and these are all aspects of the AIMS that I'm able to assess. Then when they sit down, I'm able to observe them while I'm talking. Do I see any increased blinking? And then you're able to do a few other things, which takes very little bit of time to be able to add on to your visit, and it can be integrated into those visits. Now, the AIMS is scored from 0 to 4, 0 being nothing seen, to 4 being severe or noticeable abnormal movements. You're also able to assess in the AIMS global judgment, patient awareness, and even their dental status as well. Now, when we're really beginning to look at tardive dyskinesia versus other movement disorders, a second common one that we see that we really need to know the difference in between is between tardive dyskinesia and drug-induced Parkinsonism. Well, the way I remember this is the T in tardive dyskinesia means that dopamine is turned up. So what we see is hyperkinetic, persistent, involuntary movements in the mouth, the jaw, the face, the trunk, the extremities. And these movements are caused from an increase in dopamine. Versus with drug-induced Parkinsonism, the D in drug-induced Parkinsonism means that the dopamine is turned down. So in that, you're seeing a tremor that we can see, and or bradykinesia. It could also have rigidity of the trunk, of the neck, extremities, decreased facial expression, reduced blinking of the eye, reduced arm swing. Everything is reduced. There is a reduction even in their posture or flexed posture as well. And then sometimes you can see a shuffling gait or even a freezing gait. Now, in most cases, drug-induced Parkinsonism tends to present itself earlier than that of tardive dyskinesia, because remember, tardive is truly meaning delayed. So Now, we're ready to diagnose TD as PAs today based on the patient history, understanding the symptoms and assessments that we're able to use, using our clinical judgment. But even if you're a little unsure of this, you are able to refer a patient to a psychiatric provider or a neurologic provider to make a further assessment. But I truly believe that every PA today is able to understand and assess, diagnose, screen patients, have conversations to truly get ourselves to a place where our patients can get treated and close that gap of 6 out of 10 still being undiagnosed today. Now, once the diagnosis is made, it's important to get treatment started. And I'll discuss that in our next video. Thank you so much for tuning in.